Welcome back to Beyond the Patterns. So today I have the great pleasure to announce Timothy Odonga. He holds a master's degree in electrical and computer engineering from Carnegie Mellon University and two bachelor's degrees in physics and electrical engineering from Gordon College and the University of Southern California, respectively. He has experience on working on research projects in machine learning at CMU and IBM Research. During his time at IBM Research, he was an IBM Great Minds Scholar and an AI for Good Fellow as he worked on a project on AI fairness in dermatology. The research papers from this work were accepted and published at the MICCAI 2020 conference and at NeurIPS Fair Machine Learning for Health workshop in 2019. His research interests include machine learning for healthcare, focusing on topics like fairness, explainability, and causality. So it's a great pleasure to have Timothy here, and I'm very, very much looking forward to his presentation. This is really an important topic, and I think we should consider these topics much more often. So Timothy, it's a great pleasure to have you here, and the title today will be entitled Fairness of Classifiers Across Skin Tones in Dermatology. So Timothy, the stage is yours.
Andreas, I would like to say thank you for the introduction. And as Andreas had said, the title of my presentation is Fairness of Classifiers Across Skin Tones in Dermatology. As Andreas had mentioned, this work was featured at MICCAI 2020 and at the NeurIPS Fair ML 2019 workshop. Before I start to present, I would like to acknowledge the team of incredible researchers I worked with at IBM, from the labs in Nairobi, Yorktown Heights, and Cambridge. So, I will start my talk with the background and make a case for fairness. Then I'll mention the research questions that motivated our work. Then I'll move on to the approaches we based our work on. Then I will move on to the datasets and explain our fairness pipeline. And lastly, I will share the results from the research work. So as machine learning becomes more pervasive in our lives, it's important to acknowledge the effect of bias. A study by Bellamy and group from 2019 noted that bias is an issue because machine learning in its nature is a form of statistical discrimination. This discrimination is objectionable if it places certain groups of people at a systematic disadvantage or advantage. A study by Barocas and Selt from 2016 also acknowledged that machine learning systems may place certain groups of people at a systematic disadvantage due to dataset bias. Therefore, it's important that we recognize and mitigate unwanted bias when we build machine learning systems so that they are trusted in the essential domains of deployment. Dermatology, like other medical fields, has disparities that exist with respect to ethnicity. Two studies, one from 2017 by Mahendra Rajan Group, and a study from 2011 by Wuhan Group, found that in the Black population, melanoma is often diagnosed at an advanced stage with deeper tumors. A 2015 study by Marchetti and Group found that the five-year survival rate for acral-lentiginous melanoma, ALM, was higher with whites than in Blacks, in spite of the fact that there's a lower incidence of it in Blacks. A recent study by Lester and Group from 2020 noted that the paucity of images of skin manifestations of COVID-19 in patients with darker skin is a problem because it may make identification of COVID-19 presenting with cutaneous manifestations more difficult for both dermatologists and the public. Therefore, it's important that the systems we build do not propagate these disparities. So our research work was motivated by two questions. One, standard dermatology image datasets used in machine learning tasks biased with respect to skin tone. Can we quantify this bias? And secondly, if so, does the dataset bias lead to an equal performance of downstream disease classification? So our work was based on research in skin disease diagnosis using machine learning and research on predictive inequity in computer vision with respect to skin type. Our work was based on research in skin disease diagnosis, specifically the benchmark model for melanoma diagnosis that outperformed trained dermatologists in 2016 by Odella and Group. Our work was also based on the challenges held by the International Skin Imaging Collaboration, and specifically the 2018 challenge that involved skin lesion segmentation and skin disease classification. Our work was based on research in predictive inequity in computer vision with respect to skin type, and specifically the work by Bolamini and Gebru from 2018 on automated face image analysis for gender classification, where they found that the highest misclassified subgroup was Black women. So I will move on forward to our fairness pipeline and explain the approach we used in detail. So in our fairness pipeline, you'd have your skin image datasets, which you'd pass through your skin disease classification models and your skin categorization scheme. the skin disease classification model. We take your images and return to you the predicted skin disease for the samples in the data set. For the skin tone categorization scheme, it consisted of the segmentation model. So you would give your images to the segmentation model with the ground truth masks, and the segmentation model would give you the pixels in the non-diseased region for the samples in the dataset. With the pixels from the non-diseased region, we'd move on to the skin estimation step, where the pixels, where the skin tone would be computed from the pixels in the non-diseased region. So with the estimated skin tone value for the samples in the data set and the predicted skin disease for the samples, we would evaluate the performance for a classifier with respect to the skin tone values. We used two standard dermatology image data sets, the ISIC 2018, consisting of about 10,000 dermoscopic images from 7 disease classes, with about 2,500 images with ground truth segmentation masks for the diseased area. And we also worked with the SD198, which consisted of about 6,500 clinical images from 198 disease classes. It is worth noting that the SD198 did not have ground truth segmentation masks. So we had to manually create ground truth segmentation masks as part of the pre-processing. As I had mentioned before, we had to create ground truth segmentation masks for the SD198 dataset, but before we even did that, we had to manually remove classes with images containing no observable non-diseased skin. Remember that we are estimating the skin tone using pixels from the non-diseased skin region. Some of the images contained images of the palms, soles of the feet, inside the mouth, and some of the classes that these images came from included fibroma, arsenical keratosis, and stasis ulcer, to name a few. With this step, we dropped about 62 classes and reduced the number of classes in the data set to 136, hence the name SD136. Then we manually segmented a subset of the SD136 data set to create segmentation masks. So on the top, you'll see images from some of the classes that we dropped. And on the bottom, you will see a few samples of the ground truth segmentation masks that we created. On the right of each pair of images, you will see the ground truth segmentation mask, where black represents the non-diseased skin region, which is our region of interest for estimating the skin tone. So how did we exactly do the segmentation? So we used the MICCAI CNN model, which was proposed by He and group from 2017. This was the top performing model from the ISIC 2018 challenge on lesion boundary segmentation. And for the ISIC 2018 dataset, we fine-tuned a pre-trained model, which was pre-trained on the COCO dataset. And for the SD136, we fine-tuned the previous model, which had been trained on the ISIC 2018 dataset. So for the MICCAI CNN model, we adjusted the pre-trained classifier with a faster CNN predictor with two classes, background and the mask. And we adjusted the mask predictor with a new MICCAI CNN predictor with two classes and 512 hidden neurons. We further applied thresholding techniques from classical computer vision on the predicted grayscale mask. And these approaches included contour extraction for the ISIC 2018 dataset and grid search for optimal binary thresholding for the SD136 dataset. So with the pixels from the non-diseased skin region, the next step was to estimate the skin tone value. We used a metric called the Individual Typology Angle proposed by Michelle Marlan Group in 2015. We chose this metric because it was found to be highly correlated with the melanin index. And the other reason we chose it was because the computed angular value, which makes it an objective metric. So you'd have your image, which you'd convert from RGB to CIE, lab color space, then you'd compute the IPA value using the formula here, where L quantifies the luminance, while B quantifies the amount of yellow. We used pixels with L and B values within one standard deviation of the mean to deal with outliers. Afterwards, we binned the skin tone values into bins following a scheme similar to that proposed by Casal and group in 2015. We further segregated the bins. So for some of the skin tone categories, we had light one, light two, and that was meant to get a more detailed view on the results we were getting. So the other part of our fairness pipeline was the skin disease classification model. So we used the DenseNet 201 model, which was pre-trained on ImageNet. We chose the DenseNet model because it was one of the highest performing single models from the ISIC 2018 challenge on skin disease classification. We applied regularization techniques such as dropout and early stopping. And we found that the accuracy on the internal validation data we had, it was on par with the state-of-the-art single models. With the ISIC 2018 dataset, it was on par with the benchmark model. For the SD136, the accuracy was comparable, with the caveat being that the benchmark model had been trained on 198 disease classes. So I will move on to share the findings and results from the work done. So for the segmentation step on the ISIC 2018, the MASCAS CNN model yielded an accuracy of 0.956, a false negative rate of 0.024, and a mean absolute error in ITA computation of 0.048 degrees. You see on the bottom of the screen a few samples of skin tone computed values and the bins they were placed in. It's also worth noting that the mean absolute error in computing the ITA value is a comparison of the value you get compared to the value you'd get if you used pixels in the non-diseased region of the ground truth segmentation mask. We also used the false negative rate because it would be more dangerous to classify a diseased region as non-diseased. For the SD136, the segmentation model yielded an accuracy of 0.802, a false negative rate of 0.076, and a mean absolute error in ITA computation of 3.572 degrees. As you can see, this was a more challenging data set, which meant the segmentation was more challenging. We were able to compute the skin tone value using a sample of pixels in the non-diseased region. So our work, we found that there was clearly an underrepresentation of darker skin in both data sets. You will see that on the darker end of the skin tone spectrum, there were very few samples for both of the data sets. We also found that there were a number of samples which the segmentation model failed to return a binary image, hence we placed them in the undefined bin. You'll note that for the SD136, there was a larger number of samples in the undefined bin, and this is because the segmentation for the SD136 was a bit more challenging. So we found that there was no statistically significant pattern of an equal performance by skin tone. We found this by computing the slope of the skin tone versus the accuracy for the skin tone bins and we found it to be close to zero for both of the data sets. We also did some more statistical steps to verify the conclusions we were getting. So with this work, we found that the two skin disease data sets were clearly biased towards lighter skin, with majority of the samples with ITF values between 34.5 and 48 degrees, which was the lighter end of the spectrum. We found that the bias does not seem to affect the classification results for each skin tone category, with the main caveat being that this conclusion is from datasets with significantly fewer darker skin samples. As a byproduct of the work we did, we annotated the two datasets with ITF values that denote the estimated skin tone for the samples. And we also created ground truth segmentation masks for a subset of the SD136 dataset. So the research group I worked with is still working on fairness in dermatology. Their most recent work included research on the automation of evaluation of representation in dermatology educational materials. In this work, they took a step back to look at the representation of skin tones in dermatology educational materials obtained from three dermatology textbooks. This work is by Tadesan Group. Also, there's still work going on implementation of better segmentation models for clinical images. One interesting step, which was done in the work done by Tadesan Group, was that they mapped the ITA value to the Fitzpatrick skin index for the samples. And the Fitzpatrick skin index is one of the standard indices used to classify skin tone. So I would say, I would reiterate what Andreas had said, my research interests are machine learning for health, and I'm interested in topics like fairness, interpretability, and causality. And I would also say that the research lab that I worked with in Nairobi and the group in Yorktown Heights also work on trustworthy machine learning, where they also study fairness, explainability, causality, robustness to data sets shift. And if you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them. Thank you.
Timothy, thank you very much for the presentation. And unfortunately, our audience can't applaud, but I have some applause for you, as we would have knocking on the table. It's very typical in a German lecture hall. I hope you can hear that.
Yeah, I can hear it. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that's a very important point, a very important topic that you're talking about. And I was wondering if you if you have some hints, some recommendations that you could give us when people are trying to collect data, what to keep in mind and how to organize data collection in order to avoid such biases. And I mean, this happens all the time, and it would be nice if you do have some good countermeasures.
I would say that's a good question. I would say in general, the main challenge in dermatology is that there are existing factors such as disease prevalence, which cause the bias. So that's definitely something you need to think about. The other suggestion I would say is that in the data collection, it's also important to retain and keep any metadata for the samples you collect, because I think that provides insight to what factors were involved in the collection of that data, and it also helps researchers have an understanding of the collection processes and the factors that may affect the results they are getting. So I'd say those are two of the two suggestions I could propose. Mm-hmm. I'm sure there are more.
I think this is a very good start. And of course, I think a lot of the bias is often also caused by the way how we are constructing data sets, that we have this one clinical partner and they just take the data from whoever patient just comes in, and the data distribution is essentially the same as in that particular clinic that you're working with. So I was wondering whether more international cooperation and data sharing could be a solution to this, that we just use the networks that we are building in research in order to, connect to each other and share data across the world. And maybe I'm a dreamer.
Yes, I would say that's an important thing to also consider, because I think you should be cognizant of what exactly you're building and like who you're building it for. So if you have a more inclusive partnership, then there's a chance that your results will be more representative of people in general.
Yeah, I was also wondering, when you try to organize a MICCAI challenge nowadays, you actually have a review of the entire challenge and the setup. And there are questions about the statistical measures, and there's all kinds of countermeasures that they ask for to take, not to get any misleading statistics and that the challenge is brute forced or not comparable. And we take all of these things very serious. And some, I'm not sure, maybe they already do, but I think that would be also worth, maybe not to make it mandatory because there's some very specific challenges, but at least to ask for whether there are countermeasures implemented in that challenge to prevent biases like the ones that you've been showing. So, and these are often international consortia, and they could probably do something about that. I mean, it seems not completely impossible. So this is really important that there's researchers and people like you around that look at the data very carefully and assess it and also analyze it. And I think this is really very cool research. Well, Timothy, this was really a great presentation. I enjoyed it a lot. I think you're doing really important research, and research that should be definitely visible to our entire community. So I'm very glad that you were here and gave this presentation. So I would like to thank you very much with a second round of applause.
Thank you.
Timothy, thank you very much for this great presentation. I really enjoyed it. You've seen that there were plenty of questions that we already asked during the live session. But of course, if you still have questions, you can send them to me, or you can also leave them in the comments and I'll see that they get answered. So I think this was really a great presentation, and it was really reporting some of the issues that we may not be aware of when we're constructing our databases. And you see that these are really important because they have a huge impact on performance. So please keep these things in mind if you're working on collecting databases and establishing new data for building classification systems, in particular in medicine. So thank you very much for watching, and I'm looking forward to seeing you again in one of the next episodes of Beyond the Patterns.